Hey everybody, this is Tracy here with another edition of A View from Tracy's Point. And yes, I am burning the midnight oil tonight. I was actually getting ready to log off the computer and go to bed. When I went to close out my Pacer account, I saw that Thomas Farinella did indeed file a response. And if you remember, on my last video, I stated that Judge Donnelly had, sent a notice out that if he wanted to respond to the prosecution's opposition to his motion to dismiss some of these charges, he had until the 16th to do so. And so I kept checking all day to see if he would do it, and nothing popped up. But then at the last minute, 11:59, he posted, it might have been earlier than that, but he posted his response. And so I decided to just stay up and bring this to you guys. And so let's go ahead and get into this motion. And so I'm going to go ahead and read that response to you. But before I do, there was an article that came out today or yesterday at this point, by the Metro UK or something like that. It's some, I guess, like English. I'm thinking it must be a tabloid because the article was stupid. But anyway, they were talking about R. Kelly and the fact that he's supposed to be very upset and disappointed, that none of his celebrity friends or people in the music industry are standing with him. None of them, came to his defense monetarily to help him pay for his lawyers and that type of thing. And then it went on to say that he was very upset and hurt that his fans did not stand beside him. And I was thinking to myself, now I can go with the whole, if he said that about the celebrities and the people in the music industry. But then when they got to the part about the fans and the fans not being there for him and turning against him, I was like, who put this garbage out? Like, who was the source for this article? Because if he has nothing else, he has his fan support. Like, who do they think are streaming? I think in last month or... yeah, July, his streams were up to like 6.5 million for the month of July. He's been averaging anywhere from 4 to 5 million streams per month since all of this began. And, considering the circumstances, and what he's going through and the allegations against him, that's pretty good. He's not DaBaby or somebody else, one of these other top artists that are out now, who are getting, tens of millions of streams every month. But I think that his loyal fan base is showing that they are still standing behind him, that they are there to support him. So that article kind of like pissed me off, to be honest with you. So let's go ahead and get into this motion. You guys know that the actual trial starts on Wednesday, which is tomorrow at this point. They've already seated a jury, 7 men, 5 women. Still haven't found anything on, the age, the race or anything like that of these people. There are 6 alternates. I believe it's 5 women. And one article I read said 5 women and 1 man. Another article said that it was all women that are amongst the alternates, but the actual jury that's going to be hearing the case and making the decision is 7 men, 5 women. And then in the event something happens to one of the 12 or several of the 12 and they cannot, uphold their duties throughout the remainder of the trial, then one of these alternates would be called, and they have six alternates. So Thomas Farinella got this in, like I said, at the very last second. And it says, Mr. Kelly respectfully submits this memorandum of law in reply to the government's opposition to Mr. Kelly's pretrial motion to dismiss in advance of the trial scheduled to commence on August 18, 2021. This motion seeks to dismiss the predicate acts alleged in count 1, numbers 12 and 14, as well as the Mann Act violations alleged in count 6 through count 9, and in count 1, Racketeering Act 1, 2, 3, 7, and 10. Additionally, Mr. Kelly disputes the jurisdiction and venue in the third superseding indictment filed on March 13, 2020, pursuant to Rule 12B of the Federal Rules of Criminal Procedure. So if you go back to my video, not the last video, which was the government's opposition, but the video before that, I actually read what these different charges are that they're trying to get dismissed. So you can go back and check that out. And then for the Federal Rules of Criminal Procedure, if you're interested in reading those, it's not a big document. You can just put in the search engine Federal Rules of Criminal Procedures and the number, like in this case, they're talking about Rule 12B. You can just put in Federal Rules of Criminal Procedure or FRCP Rule 12B, and a document will come up and it'll show you exactly what they're talking about when they're talking about these rules of procedure. Very short sentences, very quick, you know, easy and to the point. So he goes on to his argument. It says, one, the motion is timely. This motion disputes the court's jurisdiction and venue. On March 20th, 2020, the government, in response to Mr. Kelly's motion to strike, complained that here the government has not presented a full proffer of its evidence. Rather, the government has presented only a limited proffer of the evidence filed in support of its various motions for permanent orders of detention. And then they give you the docket number and the page that it is located on. It says, in light of the government's argument in the prior motion, and given the fact that certain sections of the instant application allege there is no evidence related to certain allegations in the indictment, Mr. Kelly filed this motion when the government's proffer of evidence should be complete. The Second Circuit has recognized that a district court can adjudge the sufficiency of the evidence before trial where the government has made a full proffer of evidence or where there is a stipulated record. See United States versus De Laurentiis, which was heard by the Third Circuit in 2000, United States versus Alfonso, which was a case heard by the Second Circuit in 1998. Consistent with this rule, the courts have fashioned the following standards to govern a pretrial motion challenging the sufficiency of an indictment. Courts regard an indictment sufficient if it sets forth the elements of the offense charged, puts the defendant on fair notice of the charges against which he must defend, and enables the defendant to assert a double jeopardy defense. United States versus Todd, which was heard by the 10th Circuit in 2006, quoting United States versus Dashney, which was heard by the 10th Circuit in 1997, in the alternative, if the court considers the government's argument as to timeliness, it is respectfully submitted that good cause has been demonstrated and the court, in accordance with Federal Rule of Criminal Procedure, Rule 12, can decide the motion. And then let's go back up here. because they had a note. So let's read the note that was cited in what I just read to you. It says, as stated in the moving papers, venue is clearly established that where the venue is challenged on a pretrial motion to dismiss, the government's burden is limited to showing that the indictment alleges facts sufficient to support the venue. United States versus Peterson from the Southern District of New York in 2005. Mr. Kelly is seeking dismissal of count one, numbers 12 and 14, as well as the Mann Act violations alleged in count six through count nine, which are the only alleged acts in the third superseding indictment that occurred. So he's basically quoting what he wrote in the original motion to dismiss. And he also repeated that earlier in this document, which I had already read to you guys. And he goes on, I think this might be new. As courts have held, the government bears the burden of proving by a preponderance of the evidence that venue exists. If the only acts that have actually been alleged in the third superseding indictment to have taken place within the Eastern District of New York are dismissed, then the government cannot prove by a preponderance of the evidence that venue properly exists in the Eastern District of New York. And then two, the motion has merit. The charges related to herpes exposure should be dismissed based on the fact that the government cannot prove the public health law section 2307, the reckless endangerment allegations should be dismissed. In the alternative, other case law indicates that infection with HIV is not a serious injury, since medical advances in recent years meant that HIV no longer poses a grave risk of death. People versus Williams. And I think I mentioned to you guys, he ended that part with, is this the case for HIV, then herpes should not be judged differently. He was coming down to the wire on this one. HIV does not cause death. People don't die from HIV. Okay. People die from complications of AIDS. I think I said that before in the previous video. So I just want to clear that up, because that is an important distinction. Even though I can't understand why they keep using HIV as their example, there should have been some cases related to herpes that he could have used to support his argument. But I guess he's trying to make the connection that HIV and herpes are both viruses, that they're not bacterial infections, I think is what he was saying, makes the difference in the case, and why this section 2307 does not apply. And so then in his notes, he writes, it is respectfully submitted that the court can consider this motion pursuant to FRCP Rule 12C and FRCP Rule 12D. So that was him telling the judge where she can find in the federal rules of evidence that supports his argument here. So B, the charges related to herpes exposure must be dismissed. The government has not disputed that herpes is not an acute bacterial venereal disease such as syphilis or gonorrhea. The New York State Department of Health stated it is not aware of any instance of an individual being charged with a misdemeanor under PHL 2307. The New York State Department of Health further commented and explained, notably, PHL 2307 was added in 1943 to prevent the spread of diseases such as syphilis and gonorrhea to members of the military during World War II. According to the legislative history, the law was amended in 1946 to apply where some knowingly exposed another person to a venereal infection. Legislative Memorandum, 1946, New York State Legislative Annual, page 191. Thus, to the extent that this section of law is enforceable, New York State Department of Health interprets it as inapplicable to individuals who have sexual intercourse where they either 1, do not know they are infected, or 2, do know they are infected and reveal that information to their consenting partners. Further, the department interprets the law as only applying to individuals who knowingly expose another individual to an acute bacterial venereal disease such as syphilis or gonorrhea. No changes have been made to the regulations in response to these comments. Exhibit A, pages 15 through 16. And then it goes on to say that the New York State Department of Health has stated that the department interprets the law as only applying to individuals who knowingly expose another individual to an acute bacterial venereal disease such as syphilis or gonorrhea. It is indisputable that when it comes to the standard of review of a government agency's interpretation of the law it enforces, the courts give deference to the agency's statutory interpretation. An agency's interpretation of the statutes it administers generally should be upheld if not unreasonable or irrational. 232, and this was a case from 2002, or ruling from 2002. And it says, in this case, the government does not dispute that the New York State Department of Health's position is the department interprets the law as only applying to individuals who knowingly expose another individual to an acute bacterial venereal disease such as syphilis or gonorrhea. Further, the government concedes Mr. Kelly's point by not disputing the New York State Department of Health's position in PHL 2307 and stated that the council's response to a public comment is not binding on this court. ECF docket number 168, page 4. And let me stop right here because I think I said in my opening that this was in response to the Jane Doe's. This is not in response to the Jane Doe's. This is in response to the throwing out the charges related to the herpes and I think the racketeering part of it. So I do apologize. And then goes on to say, however, the government ignores the established precedent that courts have applied as the standard of review for the agency's statutory interpretation. Therefore, pursuant to the agency's interpretation, PHL 2307 only applies to an acute bacterial venereal disease such as syphilis or gonorrhea, and the allegations in the indictment relating to this law should be dismissed. Moreover, the government is wrong because the cases they cite are not persuasive because the cases are clearly distinguishable from this case. The cases cited are civil cases where the burden of proof is different and do not address this issue directly. Despite the government's citation of New York Supreme Court cases, the New York courts have not been presented with this issue, which makes this a case of first impression. This is evidenced by the New York State Department of Health view of the law. In this case, the government has failed to allege anything other than herpes. There is no distinction between herpes HSV-1 and genital herpes HSV-2. If the court accepts this broad interpretation of the government's view of PHL 2307, then this would be as if the statute was amended. It would be nothing more than the exercise of the power of judicial review to set aside government acts which would be unconstitutional. unduly prejudicial to Mr. Kelly, and it would violate his constitutional rights. If the PHL 2307 law is not dismissed in this case, it will set the precedent that which could potentially lead to the government charging expectant mothers who have become pregnant after knowing they have herpes HSV1 and have knowingly exposed their children to herpes for such exposure. Moreover, when that child turns 18, they could sue the mother for said exposure. Therefore, the court's holding that an agency's interpretation of the statutes it administers generally should be upheld if not unreasonable or irrational is for a reason. It would be completely unreasonable or irrational if herpes was written into PH 2307 and when the concept of genital herpes did not exist when the statute was passed. C. Count 1 is barred by the statute of limitations. The allegations contained in Count 1, Racketeering Act 1, Racketeering Act 3, Racketeering Act 5 should be dismissed because the alleged violations of law occurred outside the prescribed statutory period of time such claims should be made or could be made. Count 1, Racketeering Act 1, bribery, asserts the violation of Illinois Criminal Code Sections 533-1A and 551. He was really rushing to type this up, and he obviously didn't proofread it. So under this, I'm going to say, is a 3-year statute of limitation for the above mentioned section. The alleged act is to have occurred on August 30th, 1994. The allegation in the complaint was made on or about March 13, 2021. He got match 13. This is clearly well beyond the 3-year statute of limitations. Therefore, count 1, Racketeering Act 1 should be dismissed. Additionally, the general federal statute of limitations for felonies. Oops, hold on. I lost my page, y'all. I was looking at this note, but it was basically a statement out of the previous motion where he talks about the definition of venereal diseases does not include herpes, venereal disease, a disease that is contracted and transmitted by sexual contact, caused by microorganisms that survive on the skin or mucous membranes, or that are transmitted via semen, vaginal secretions, or blood during intercourse. The genital areas provide a moist, warm environment that is especially conducive to the proliferation of bacteria, viruses, and yeast. So a great many diseases can be transmitted this way, including AIDS, chlamydia, genital warts, gonorrhea, syphilis, yeast infections, and some forms of hepatitis. And then he gives the website where he got that information from. Okay, so then he goes on. Okay, so this is where, let me go back and start this sentence over where I lost my page. So therefore, count 1, Racketeering Act 1 should be dismissed. Additionally, the general federal statute of limitations for felonies stand for the proposition that the government can no longer file charges for an offense once 5 years has passed. The federal statute of limitations is 18 United States Code 3282. This statute states, except as otherwise expressly provided by law, no person shall be prosecuted, tried, or punished for any offense, not capital, unless the indictment is found or the information is instituted within 5 years. Next, after such offense shall have been committed. Count 1, Racketeering Act 3, Count 1, Racketeering Act 1, kidnapping asserts the violation of Illinois Criminal Code Sections 510.1 and 551. Under the Illinois Criminal Code Section 720 ILCS 510-1, 720 ILCS 510-2, there is a 3-year statute of limitation for the above mentioned section. The alleged act is to have occurred in or about and between 2003 and 2004. The allegation in this complaint was made on or about, he says, match again, March 13, 2021. This is clearly well beyond the 3-year statute of limitations. Therefore, Count 1, Racketeering Act 1, should be dismissed. Additionally, the general federal statute of limitations for felonies stand for the proposition that the government can no longer file charges for an offense once 5 years has passed. The federal statute of limitations, 18 U.S.C. 3282, this statute states, except as otherwise expressly provided by law, no person shall be prosecuted, tried, or punished for any offense, not capital, unless the indictment is found or the information is instituted within 5 years next after such offense shall have been committed. D, Racketeering Act 2, Racketeering Act 7, and Racketeering Act, he left the number out, he meant to say Act 10, should be dismissed. So Count 1, Racketeering Act 2, Racketeering Act 7, and Racketeering, he was really, really rushing, y'all. I hate to keep stopping, but I'm just really, I don't know if this is, if he loses points for some of these errors that are in here. It says, in Racketeer Act 10, which include the allegation that certain Jane Does engaged in sexually explicit conduct for the purpose of producing one or more visual depictions of such conduct. However, there is no evidence that visual depictions exist. Therefore, as a matter of law, and because it is impossible to find that Mr. Kelly to find the Mr. Kelly of these allegations. Okay. Because it is impossible to find Mr. Kelly, I'm not sure what he's trying to say here, of these allegations. These allegations. He left out part of his sentence, so I don't know what he's trying to say there. But he's saying that the allegations should be dismissed, but I'm not sure why. I mean, I know why, but he's not clear in this sentence as to why. Additionally, a victim's uncorroborated statements are not always admissible. The court have held, further, although a victim's statements are generally admissible, not all statements by victim are considered reliable hearsay. Unsworn statements of the victim are admissible if there is a requisite indicia of reliability and the statement is not equivocal, inconsistent with other evidence, or dubious in light of other information in the record. Conclusion, for the foregoing reasons, Mr. Kelly respectfully asks this court to grant his motion to dismiss in its entirety. So he didn't really go, he said a lot of what was already said in the original motion, and he didn't address a lot of what the prosecution was saying. And I think we can all agree that the prosecution was being somewhat disrespectful in their opposition motion, and they were kind of like talking down on him like he didn't know the law. And so he's basically reiterating what the law says. And I hate that he didn't address, because one of the things that the prosecution said was that according to this 18 USC code, where it talks about when you're using state regulations, that the statute of limitations for the state is superseded by federal rules. And they were saying that the federal rule states that if they have one crime that occurred in the 5 years prior to the indictment, then that allows them to bring older charges in. And he doesn't argue that point. He doesn't make clear that their interpretation of that law is wrong. And so it'll be up to Judge Dunley to decide if it's 5 years, period, doesn't matter what happened prior to the indictment, you know, 5 years prior to the indictment, does the alleged acts that happened within those 5 years then open the door for stuff that happened almost 30 years ago to come into play? He didn't get to that point. He didn't argue that point. He's basically saying that I guess that doesn't exist. You know, he's reiterating that you only have the number of years according to the statute in the state. So if the state statute says 5 years, then it's 5 years. It doesn't matter if it's being charged at the state level or the federal level. If it's 3 years, it's 3 years. He just doesn't address the part that they said allowed them to bring all these old allegations into this case and be a part of their indictment. So I don't know if that's going to hurt him, hurt his argument or not. And then the part about the herpes, he basically just reiterated what he said in the previous motion, where he's saying that at the time that this 2307 PHL 23 public health law 2307 was enacted, it was enacted back in the 1943, I believe, and then there was like an amendment maybe in 47 or something. But they're saying that when these laws were written, genital herpes was not a recognizable disease, whether it's bacterial or what, or viral infection. It wasn't recognized until the 60s. And that if the government intended for that to be a part of this law, this PHL 2307, then they would have gone back and amended the law to include herpes. They would have spelled it out. But because they have not revisited this law in all these years, then they cannot apply it to the herpes charges or create charges for herpes using this New York law, if that makes sense. And that seems to be the only things that he addressed in this motion. It was obvious that he was rushing to get this done and get it submitted. She told him the 16th. She didn't say what time on the 16th. And so he took it up to the last minute, 11:59, made sure he filed the motion. I'm sure there was more that he probably wanted to say, but he was just, I don't know what he was doing over the weekend, to be honest, that he didn't work on it. But he basically just reiterated what he said in the original motion. You know, I said what I said. I need you to deal with it. And so right now, Judge Dunley will have to review this. And I'm sure she's already made her decision. She was just letting him know that if he wanted to file a rebuttal to the government's opposition, he needed to do so. She'll probably make her ruling tomorrow, because I'm sure she already knows what she's going to say, whether she's going to allow it or not allow it. And so we should hear something by close of business tomorrow. And definitely, well, it has to be close of business tomorrow, because the trial starts, well, today, because it's already the 17th. I'm sorry. Trial starts on the 18th. So this matter has to be settled before the case starts. So we should hear from her later on today what her decision is going to be. So guys, that's it for me. It is 12:43, and I'm, you know, I'm tired. You probably can hear it in my voice. So I'm going to go ahead and close this out. Go ahead, leave your comments below, rate the video, and subscribe to the channel if you haven't done so already. And until the next time, I shall talk to you guys later. Bye-bye.